aboard me. It's just life. And I will take you. With the south wind in my feather, I was you home again. Weary clansmen leave Culloden and let your life Redbird in Caledonia and feet of
fire. Well, it is working out.
Okay. All right. I hope you can. It's my great honour to be able to, first of all, welcome Aunty Jean here, who's going to do share with us. So can I just invite you forward, Aunty Jean, to come and share.
Thank you, Pastor. I'm a Queenslander, and I met John over 50 years ago. He came into our Aboriginal community, which is in southeast Queensland. One of our great Aboriginal pastors, Pastor David Kirk, brought him to us. In those days, we weren't allowed off our communities, but non-Aboriginal people had to get special permission to come in to us. I grew up through the Aborigines Inland Mission, one of the biggest missionary societies in this country. And they had a big church in Cherbourg, where many of us came out of. And John came there to visit us. In that church, we had the biggest Christian endeavour in the state of Queensland. And I don't know whether you know, but John was a great man for Christian endeavour. And we had many rallies in that area. And John came to speak to us. And one of my nieces, who lives in Coffs Harbour, she and her husband are wonderful Christian people. And Glennie, today, always remember the impact that John had upon her life and other Aboriginal people. I'm one of the well-known Aboriginal Christian leaders in this country. My whole life has been given to Aboriginal ministries. And I want to thank God today for people like John. In 1982, at the Commonwealth Games in Brisbane, John came to us. Because as you know, that John had a real heart for justice. And I trust that all of us today will be challenged by John's life and the impact that it's made upon this nation And I'm meeting people all around this nation who've been impacted by John's ministry. And he came to us in 82 at the Commonwealth Games. One leading politician said, "Who is this man that's come?" I said, "He's a friend of Aboriginal people. And he'll be supporting Aboriginal people for justice in this city." And we organised a big church service, a rally, right in the heart of Brisbane. And John spoke and made a real impact upon the lives of many of those people. And many of them didn't go along to the Commonwealth Games because they knew the message from John. John looked at the history of this nation, and we're still dealing with that history today. And so, Glenna, I want to thank you and the family for enabling me and giving me the opportunity of sharing in this event today. John has meant so much to so many of us, and I'm here representing the Aboriginal people, but more so the Aboriginal Christian community in this nation. And many of them would have liked to have been here today. The way that God has worked it, I came down for surrender, and it worked out very well that I'm able to be here today. And I trust that many of you will come on the journey with us like John has. I've become a very good friend of John. And many people who John administered to here in the city, or in the city of Melbourne, are today journeying with us and supporting our ministry. And some of them are here today, and I want to thank you for it. I hope that you'll get to know us as Aboriginal people. I hope that you will come on the journey with us today. We need each other in this nation. This nation is in a real mess because we've not dealt with the history of this nation. And someone like John Smith did that. And I'm praying that God will raise up people, and maybe some of you, no matter how old you are or how young you are, that you might get to know us and deal with the history of this nation so we can come together as one people. So thank you, Glenna. Thank you to your family. Thank you to you young people. Get to know us as Aboriginal people. We are your friends, and we trust that you'll be our friends. So thank you very much for giving me this opportunity, Glenna and the family.
So my name's Mark Johnstone, and it's my honour to be able to welcome you to our spaces, squishy as it is. And I know there are dudes out there, further out, even outside there. Welcome, and may you be blessed today as we hear about the message of our wonderful man. A message that transformed my life, and I'm so indebted for that, that as a 17-year-old kid, a book was placed in my hands, and it transformed my very life. I've had a message about the real Jesus, and I give God the glory for that book that an old lady in my church knew I was a bit off the rails and gave it to me. So welcome to this space, and may it be a wonderful space for you today. God bless you. I'm just going to hand over to Ian Clarkson. Thanks.
Yeah, thank you very much, Mark, for those words of welcome and the sentiments which you've expressed. My name's Ian Clarkson. I'm a minister of the Word from South Australia, and I've known John and the Smith family for many, many years. Let's dedicate this service to the Lord, shall we pray? Father, we thank you for the ministries and the gifts that you give to human beings that bring about your kingdom being advanced on this earth. And particularly today, we thank you for those gifts and graces which you gave to your servant, John. And Father, we pray that during this time together, we shall be inspired to walk more closely with you, to hear the voice of the Lord Jesus, the appointed King and ruler. Help us, Father, as we share together. Let our hearts be tender, our minds be ready to hear the whispers of your grace. For we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, it was 40 degrees plus. It was a torrid day and it was a blistering hot with a north wind blowing. And it was Woodna, which is about 400 kilometres west of Adelaide. And Woodna is about halfway between Melbourne and Perth. Now, I'd read a little bit about the Jesus movement. I'd picked up some of the Truth and Liberation Concern papers. And I knew that there was something wonderful happening somewhere over there in the big smoke in either Sydney or Melbourne somewhere, but didn't know much more than that. Then there was a knock on the door, of the manse door. And my wife answered as she came down. She said, "Jesus is at the door." or somebody who looks just like him. So I went there, and there, sweat pouring off him, long shoulder-length hair, those dark, piercing but languid eyes. There he was. We spent about 7 minutes together. That was about it. And then John was gone on this, I think, was the first real God Squad major sortie, and they'd picked the big one. They had about 1,500 kilometres to go. And John was wearing, I thought he was wearing some sort of sheepskin as well. I thought, how can he survive? But he hopped on his Honda 754 and headed off into the western dusk. And I thought, I guess I'll never see him again, ever. It was just like that. But we did. And it's been wonderful in that relationship. I think there was a real symbiosis between John's ministry and the great ministry of John Wesley. I'm not saying it's of the same dimension, but there's certainly a symbiosis. And when John was heading off on that adventure across to Perth with the embryonic God Squad, he was heading off on what would probably result, as the years went by, according to Bruce Chambers, something like 2.25 million miles on not horseback like John Wesley, but on his motorbike. Wesley did 225,000 miles on horseback and preached 40,000 sermons. I reckon John would probably have eclipsed that here in Australia. So he was on the road, and the nation was his parish. As Wesley said, the world was his parish. And of course, John's ministry went beyond Australia as well. It was a ministry that was focused on those who are on the edge of society. Just as Wesley went to the miners and to the labourers in Sussex, some of whom turned up in Australia. They were transported here like the Loveless brothers. So John went to those who were left out, who were on the margins, who were sometimes despised and sometimes didn't know where they were at for all sorts of reasons. So it's a ministry that we today, at this somewhat carnival atmosphere, shall celebrate and give thanks to God for, because he gives the gifts and graces. He gives them to us. And sometimes he lets us kind of take a bit of credit for it ourselves. But it all comes from him. One of the things that John had that was strong in his ministry was a perception, understanding of music. And he used that as a kind of a lingua franca to understand culture. John also loved the music of the Wesleyan period. Those songs that the miners loved, the rich lyrics that Charles Wesley composed. And we're going to sing one of those right now. It's probably the classic hymn from the Wesleyan period. And John's eclectic taste for music included this as one of his great songs. Love Divine, All Loves Excelling.
Thank you. Good afternoon. It's a full house. I hope it's not a tough crowd. So, Steve Drury is my name, and I'm going to speak about a 10-year period from 85 to 95. Pre-internet, pre-social media, and where I guess we worked, I think we used to say we worked in real time. But I hope that this context of that 10 years will try and encapsulate something of effort and risk and cost and reward in John's ministry and the team that surrounded him at that time. So I am speaking in the context of that 10 years, and some of this obviously is past tense. I want to start with some other people's words. Senator Michael Tate was the Minister for Justice under the Hawke and Keating governments, and he said, "I can think of no other Australian who has earned the admiration and respect of so many in spite of constantly challenging the assumptions and practices of their lifestyle." I'll mention more about Senator Tate later on. Carolyn Jones from the ABC said, "John's attunement to Australia today and the authenticity of his teaching from personal experience make him an inspiration for our nation today." Professor Sam Marumba, who's now at the Brooklyn Law School in New York and regularly lectures the New York State Judiciary, said, "At Monash University, where I taught law for the last 13 years, I watched with amazement the Alexander Theatre fill up to standing room only in session after session of John Smith's incisive discourses on education, rational inquiry, faith, justice, love, integrity, compassion, relationships, etc. However, maybe one of the best quotes was written by John in the back of one of his books. It says, "Glenna Smith, my remarkable wife and mate, who again allowed yet another deadline to encroach on our precious holiday time. When she assisted me to rewrite and retype part of this book." That book went on to win the 1990 Australian Religious Book of the Year. I don't know where that stands in, you know, on the New York Times bestseller list, or even if it does, but it was a significant piece, and Glenna was right there, front and centre, making it happen. Time provides perspective, and today I pay tribute to John for providing many of us a unique opportunity to add our own skills to the task that he led. Our skills were individual, but John's message became our message too. Glenna, their family, their church, John's directors, care and communication, God Squad, St Martin's, are all a part of that story. Time can provide perspective. In the mid-80s, John's organisation was led by a board of directors, and Hank Petruzma was a parliamentarian and businessman. Hank was a visionary. As chairman, he and the directors were seeing the increased demands of a growing organisation with stretched resources and a small team. They invited me to work with them and develop and expand John's ministry, and today I've been asked to talk about that 10-year period, just one decade of John's long life of work and service. I came from a career in commercial advertising and events, and I believe that skill set might be able to assist John and the team. It was a daunting task. I had met John and Glenna previously, heard John and the squad members speak several times. I found them compelling and hard to ignore. I remember being up front with John and his board that we could not pursue a national and international profile, chase media coverage, publish books, create expectations, and then back off or back out. This would be a long, hard run. John was resolute, as were Hank and the directors, so we got to work. In every respect, those years were a team effort. It wasn't perfect, hard lessons were learnt, strong views were held and expressed. But this also spoke to the health of the organisation. It compelled review and self-assessment. It sharpened commitment and message, and we kept going. In 10 years, John and the team presented to hundreds, I use these terms because I know and I was there and I use these terms and they are true, hundreds of thousands of people face to face and millions more through media in Australia, New Zealand, UK, Europe, USA and elsewhere. And these are just some of those examples. 48 mission events, typically 1 or 2 weeks each, representing faith, values, meaning in all Australian states and territories. in public speaking, almost weekly forums across education, civic, government, business and industry and arts groups, human rights presentations and study tours. John put himself at risk in the Philippines, Central America, Eastern Europe, Switzerland for an international cities conference on the disintegration of cities and what might be done about it, and the United Nations Human Rights Commission in Geneva and members of the British House of Commons. In terms of media coverage, radio spots on values, ethics and faith were on 120 radio stations around this country for a period of over 6 years. He was interviewed by the ABC and commercial radio across the country, every major current affairs and or morning variety program. It's a long list. In the United Kingdom, we would approach UK media and take up the opportunities. And in terms of the UK, David Frost, Good Morning Britain, London Weekend Television, Terry Wogan, Central TV, The London Times, The Independent, BBC Radio 1, Radio 4, and BBC World Service. in terms of face-to-face in Europe and England, in Holland, and in other places, but Holland, New Zealand, UK and USA, arts festivals, social justice conferences, and I number here for main stage, Greenbelt, Christian artists, Flavo and DeBron, more than 50,000, and that doesn't include repeat visits. Publishing of four books, and this one that was mentioned right at the start, won the Christian Book of the Year in the UK, selling 65,000 copies in secular bookshops. Bono wrote a foreword for that, and I'll just paraphrase, truly a preacher to the convertible, John Smith's message is for people who want to do more than just listen. Excuse me. I'm trying to race through this. But I shouldn't race through it. This is about John and his stuff. This is about John. With John at the helm, it was a capable outfit. The team were essential to the size and scope of the ministry which John inspired and led. These people were significant, and I want to mention them, and I apologise for any I've missed. The chair and board members, Hank Petruzma, John Curtis, Tim Costello, John Cleary, John Waller, David Freeman, Tom Glynn, John Bryant, Ian Milne, Andrew Boog, Sheila Wilkin, Mike Rule, Hank, John and Tim and the board dealt with the growing pains of a dynamic organisation. They committed themselves to supporting John's ministry. Staff and team members from early days included Trevor Chambers, Mandley Halsall, Martin Newman and Quincy, then Dave Fuller, Steve Barrington, Shirley Osborne, Tony Kokonis, Ruth Duck, Rosemary Spillane, and later Kevin Maddock, Rod Brown, Glenna Smith, Keith Waters and volunteer Alan Harvey. And then there were John's many associates outside of the organisation, people like John Uran and Athol Gill, and there are many more. Across the population, the contest for hearts and minds was intense, as was the open distrust of organised religion. Audiences could not be reached from the office desk or from the church pulpit, but John already knew this. Thousands of miles and hours were spent going to where people lived, worked and socialised, listening and engaging on their own terms. John called it action reflection, and that was the model that the team adopted. And this rigorous self-education and resetting of their central message was continual. John's gifts and skills were comprehensive and advanced, an appetite for knowledge, ability to research, a deep understanding of culture, empathy for people, ability to craft messages and engage audiences, a love of music. These things fueled his communication. And before any major presentation, John would insist on knowing the context. Who am I speaking to? What are the issues they face? And for mission trips to regions, towns and cities, he wanted the local stats. Population trends, unemployment, socioeconomic profile, local industries, youth issues. John would devour it all. When he took to the stage, he had studied the context and prepared comprehensively. When Dave Fuller, Steve Barrington, Shirley Osborne took to the microphone, their straight-up style and authenticity established an immediate rapport. As John rose to speak, the room fell silent in curious expectation and respect. others such as Fuzz Kiddo, Dennis Clare, Tony Williams, Steve Grace and Rob Timms assisted the team and John on the road. Similarly in the UK, Sammy Horner, Martin Joseph and Heather Kurnow assisted John. These people assisted John and were experienced communicators in their own right. Trevor Chambers' consistent work saw the collection of base material for hundreds of separate briefs for presentations here and overseas, drawing on topical and social issues. All of this to assist John with valuable input for a sharp, incisive message. Trevor researched and drafted thousands of radio spots for John to edit and record, and we negotiated, I think I mentioned, 120 stations across all states and produced these bi-monthly year after year, always with fresh material. To his credit, John would take those briefs and assiduously reworked, reshaped on the plane, in the car and in the studio before he put mouth to microphone. Keith Waters' significant experience in frontline services with youth and marginalised groups brought direction and structure to existing and new outreach programs. His knowledge added organisational strength and development, accountability and strategic government relationships. Glenn has many roles, including John's assistant and secretary, church liaison, partner, supporter and friend, was consistent and fundamental to John's ministry throughout these years. John would say often that he could not have continued if he didn't have Glenn's help right there. A few stories are indicative of the time, the effort and the risk. On one mission, John was sitting with ministers preparing for the local visit and asked for a profile of the local clubs and the local pubs. He had to explain to them that the team's approach to each of the six pubs in town would be different depending on the clientele on any given night and at any time on any of those nights. In 1992, the largest single mission event of the time was 3 weeks in Newcastle and Hunter Valley, New South Wales. After a full day, after the evening rallies, after everyone else was exhausted, John would stay up until the wee hours, meticulously going over high school stats for the next day to decide which team was best suited to represent at that school and to present at that school. There were 70 schools to visit in 3 weeks. There were meetings with business, meetings with churches, meetings in jails, with the media, the rugby club, the power station workers, the mayor and councillors, the high school teachers, the local university. The team divided the task of over 200 events in 3 weeks. 170 churches were involved. The mayor of Newcastle was the patron, and they held 100 preparation meetings in the 18 months prior to the event. This was the largest, but not unique. In 10 years, John and the team, as I said, led 48 missions to every state and territory in Australia. Some were small, some were large, all were important. Three people in this room had a role in saving John Smith and Martin Newman's life. One night, Shirley Osborne phoned me from the Philippines. She'd made it back to Manila from Mindanao, where John and Martin had been arrested for taking part in a demonstration against the bulldozing of poor people's families. The local militia stated that they would be executed the next morning. I think John and Martin spent a restless night. Shirley was getting very little help from the officials at the evangelism conference in Manila that they were all to attend in the days ahead. My first call was to Hank Petruzma, who is here, who ranked Senator Michael Tate. I cannot confirm, but I believe our government got involved. I rang Reuters and the ABC to raise media attention, but the next phone call I received that night came from the leader of the Australian delegation to that conference in Manila, asking us not to risk the reputation of their conference. I believe we ignored their request. By morning, it was essentially an international incident and the story was in international media. The work of Bob Geldof and Bono influenced a UK charity to advocate for prisoners of conscience. Jubilee Campaign asked John to speak at the UNHCR in Geneva. To brief John, we enlisted Senator Michael Tate, Brian Burdekin, and Professor Sam Marumba, a human rights lawyer. John prepared meticulously and spoke for 20 minutes. The Human Rights Commission took up the case with the offending government and the people were released. We arranged for John to speak at Greenbelt Festival in England and other European festivals from 87 onwards. He was a repeat guest many times over. I have 1 minute to go. On average, John's audio tapes and books were the highest selling, and his seminars were a must-see for festival goers. John was also a main contact in getting Midnight Oil to sing at, and play, at perform at Greenbelt in 1992, from memory. John always missed his family and St Martin's Church family back home. Many times he was distressed knowing he would be missing a family event or a precious Sunday activity. He would then get up and go again and go on stage in front of hundreds who had come to hear him, or to a small group of teenagers who wanted to quiz him about faith, life, or their next girlfriend. John would give them his time. Finally, I pay tribute to John Glenner and their family for their great gift to the rest of us. Constantly challenging, constantly rewarding, it was an honour to work with John Smith. John challenged all of us, as indeed he challenged himself. Somehow he would find the energy and always, always keep going. Thank you.
John, just like Jesus, always had time for those who were the unknown, the insignificant, and the unimportant. He gave his time freely. And I'm very grateful to God for that. John believed in me in ways that I'm only just beginning to understand, like many of you. And I'm incredibly grateful for that. A few years ago, he asked if I would sing this song for you today, and so I give it to you as a song that he chose for you today, among others. An adventure with John was his conversations, and he would say it was a little bit like a long walk in the bush, and if you only make it to the third gum tree, then that's okay. Have a sit down and a rest, and I'll come back for you. For many of us, we feel like we're just at that third gum tree. For some of us, we feel like we've been walking a little bit longer, but all of us are walking together, and all of us, like John, are following Jesus. He was a pioneer. You thrive on going where no one has gone. Still it gets lonely when the darkest deepens. So sing by the fire till the dawn. You travel light, you travel alone. And when you arrive, nobody knows, but the Father in heaven, he is glad you can go. For those who come after you will need the road. Pioneer, pioneer, keep pressing on. Father goes before you to your own frontier, your abiding ear. And what you have done, others will do bigger and better and faster than you. But you can't look back. No, you can't stay here. There's a wilderness pathway that is calling you, calling you. Pressing onward, no, you can't stay here. Only the Father goes before you to your own frontier, your pioneer. Only the Father goes before you to your own frontier.
Thanks, Diane. Good afternoon. My name is Sean, part of God Squad in South Wales in the United Kingdom. And the club has asked me to write a tribute to John, which I did. And Glenna has asked me to read this to you today. Before I do that, on my way here, had an 11th hour email from a travelling Irish musician called Bono, who wishes to bring this tribute to his friend, John the Baptist Smith. My first sense of John the Baptist Smith was observing cassettes of his preaching being passed around like he was some kind of obscure indie rock band, which in so many ways he kind of was. But he had hits. John got pop culture. On one cassette, he was uncovering the Blakeyan influence of Kris Kristofferson. On another, his exegesis was on Bette Midler's movie, The Rose, which he opened up like it was a missing gospel. On another, he broke down talking about an outlaw biker called Bull Baring, whose deep knowledge of the blues had opened John's own mind to the possibility of psalms hiding in the form. The brutal honesty of the blues made sense to John and made sense of John. John Smith was the only one not surprised to hear the Hell's Angels jam, "Were You There When They Crucified My Lord?" John quite liked that some churchy people thought of him as a heretic, a big smile across his face. "You mean like Jesus, matey?" To John, the Bible was an incendiary tract, not some handbook on religion. It was not a sop for a mankind's fear of death, but it was an epic poem about life. It spoke about culture. It spoke about politics. It spoke about justice. Yeah, so here's to you, John the Baptist Smith. A voice crying in the wilderness, "Let the valleys be raised and the mountains laid low. Make way for the coming of the Lord and make it flat as a freeway, please. With no speed limits, if possible." Yay. "Let the pilgrims know Jesus will take the back seat, but if ye want the ride of your life, give him the handles and hold on tight." Bob Dylan sang, always on the other side of whatever side that there was. He might have been singing about John, an outsider in an outsider community, an outlaw of a different kind, preparing the way for the coming of a different kind of world, speaking truth to power. It didn't matter who you were, didn't matter if he was your guest. In our last meeting, he spoke truth to me, gave me a hell of a hard time, thought I had gone soft and become too comfortable around the powerful, thought I was living too well. He was probably right. I still think about it. I hope the Archangel Michael is not wearing Gucci loafers. He'll be getting it in the neck from our John the Baptist Smith if he is. And that comes with love to you, Glenna, and your family from Bono. But I'm here primarily at this moment in time on behalf of the 400 or so that make up the current community of God Squad in 16 countries around the world. And it's on their behalf I bring these words. And I hope that there's something in here that warms your heart, that maybe makes you laugh, maybe makes you cry. And I hope it encourages you as well. Kevin John Smith. Smithy. The Reverend Doctor. Bullfrog. John. The General. Our Commander-in-Chief. Our Founder. Our President. And for nearly five decades, our teacher. He was an academic, a pastor, a preacher, an author, a prophetic voice, an irritant to a comfortable church, an advocate for justice, the poor, the marginalised, and the arts. A music lover, a bookworm, and biker. And more significantly, John was a husband, father, grandpa, brother, an uncle. He could be both complex and incredibly direct. Andy Turner, writing on behalf of Greenbelt Festival in the UK, commented in his own tribute that John could be an impossible, absurd mix of contradictions, intense, chaotic, tactless, driven, at times heavy-handed, curious, compassionate, tender, broken and brilliant. I would add, any amount of time in John's company and the conversation could cover a multitude of topics in just a few minutes. It could be poetry, theology, matters of justice, the natural world, politics, music, literature and history, all with immense authority and enthusiasm. He could be a bloke's bloke one minute and a hopeless romantic the next, shedding a tear at the drop of a hat. He had the capacity to be so brutally honest about the finer details of his own body falling apart, it could make your skin crawl. And then at the next moment, he could be talking about the history of mission movements in Central America without pausing for breath. But Smithy was also a biker who covered hundreds of thousands of miles. And it was with God Squad Christian Motorcycle Club he hit the road throughout Australia and many other countries as well, as the club grew in Europe, New Zealand and also the USA. For Smithy, the road was the place of discipleship and mission. And like John Wesley, one of his mission inspirations, the world very much became his parish. It was where you worked out what it meant to be a follower of his hero, Jesus of Nazareth. The road would take you to the marginalised. He taught us that the gospel still ought to be good news for the poor and uncomfortable news for the powerful. He remained passionate about the need for the message of Jesus to be faithfully proclaimed in the public sphere. But he also taught us that it should be something that should be lived. Putting it into practice was not an optional extra. And this is significant. He taught us how the Bible was not a book to pull proof texts from. to justify personal gain. And neither should we conveniently skip over the hard-to-read passages like loving your enemies and doing good to those who persecute you. He introduced us to new travelling companions in the scriptures, such as Jeremiah and his laments, the countercultural prophetic voices of Amos and Micah, which saw him at his most animated, in full flight, preaching on a festival stage. He highlighted the frailty of King David and introduced us to the blues songs in the Psalms that pointed to the hope of the gospel. The road trips of Jesus connecting with outcasts and undesirables saw him, even in failing health, burst with enthusiasm at the all-embracing love of God that was at work long before we would ever ride into town. And he never lost his enthusiasm for the Apostle Paul's ability to cross borders and be a cultural chameleon, which he himself did so well. John was able to connect with people in a myriad of contexts, whether it be in a smoky clubhouse bar, backstage at a rock and roll gig, or in the corridors of political power, a chapel pulpit, a street corner talking to a complete stranger, sitting amid indigenous communities, engaging in academic dialogue, or crying in the pouring rain at the graveside with a grieving family. And whilst he would often rage against the weaknesses of the church, he passionately believed in the need for Christian community, genuine fellowship, brotherhood and sisterhood together. If you couldn't cope with the organised church, he would say, then be part of the disorganised one. But don't go it alone. He taught us that we need each other in all our shapes and sizes. And God Squad reflects this rich diversity still today and remains something of a miracle that it functions at all. Such is the broad cross-section of personalities, stories, Christian experience, denominational preference, and psychological makeup. On paper, it shouldn't work, but it does, precariously balancing between complex dysfunction and bordering on brilliance. God Squad remains a unique testimony to a unique pioneer in countercultural mission. John was able to nurture God Squad chapters globally alongside his international speaking schedule. When Smithy was in town, it wasn't a matter of flash hotels and first-class travels. He mucked in with our local communities, living with us and travelling with us. Smithy coming to stay would always be a bizarre mix of experiences. You didn't just get John, his colours and his Bible. You got a plethora of excess baggage. Boxes of books. At least half a dozen Broad Street newspapers blowing down the street in the wind. A new gadget that he'd bought and couldn't get to work. You got something that needed fixing, usually either himself, his glasses, or his laptop, or possibly all three. And before you knew it, your fridge would be full of specialist local beers and your sink full of empty bottles as he soaked the labels off of them for his collection. And a hat. There would always be a hat. And it would always be left somewhere and need to be found. In the middle of all this, there will be clubhouse visits, pastoral visits, speaking engagements, media appointments, all whilst being jet-lagged and, in recent years, increasing amounts of pain. It could be an exhausting experience, but somehow we would all look forward to it and every chapter would move mountains to accommodate the brilliance and the chaos that was John Smith. And you savoured these moments. But it wasn't always straightforward. There have been huge disappointments along the way, with some conflicts and some loose ends. He would have loved to have seen a wide network of grassroots church communities connected with this ministry. There are some, but maybe the greater gift and legacy has been the significant number of God Squad members in ministry across a broad sweep of mainstream denominations and welfare sectors, committed to a countercultural gospel that believes things don't have to stay the way they are. Over the years, there's been some fractures, and the struggle of leadership transition has been a very real and challenging one at times. But Smithy our brother, our visionary, our voice, crying in the wilderness, leaves a legacy that spurs us on passionately for the long haul in sacrificial obedience to our Lord. It's a legacy that finds its core values in the kingdom of God and in the Sermon on the Mount. It speaks into our character, our relationships, our lifestyle, and our collective ministry together, and will not surrender in the face of ridicule, oppression, or our own fragility. It needs to be said publicly also that as a community of people, God Squad sends our deepest love and the assurance of our ongoing prayers to Glenna, to Paul, to Kathy, to Lyndall, and your families. Over the years, they have endured many sacrifices for the cause of this ministry, but they have also endured times of pain and heartache because of our own collective dysfunction. Sometimes there has been a reluctance for us as a community to acknowledge our flaws, and we realise there has been a price that you and others should not have had to pay. And we regret that with tears and a resolute commitment that this must change. John died sleeping in the arms of his bride of over 50 years, who has stood by him through thick and thin, lived through the dramas of this most unique of ministries and remarkable of lives. And as we honour John today, we also honour Glenna in these moments. We are sad, but we are grateful. We are grateful for a life shared on the road that brought us closer to the heart of Jesus, and a belief that ordinary broken people can make a difference. We are hopeful because of the assurance of our faith in this same Jesus that John is now enjoying this beautiful day, where the kingdom has finally come, where the colours are bleeding into one, and there are no more questions, no more doubts, and no more pain. As God's God, we want to thank you for your support in these days, and to our friends in motorcycle clubs that are here and around the world. Thank you to each one of you that gave a welcome to John personally. He treasured all these times and took none for granted. For nearly 47 years, he wore the colours of God's God Christian Motorcycle Club. He brought a depth to their meaning that we shall endeavour to retain as we continue the journey. And I want to finish with some of his own words. On the occasion of Melbourne Chapter's 25th anniversary in 1997, John wrote the following, and it still applies today. Our faith and commitment remain stronger than ever. You need a faith to live by and a friend to stand by. Like Jesus, who we follow, we are committed friends of the outcasts of this world. We are friends not to manipulate our mates to faith, but because we talk and live a faith that is free for all. True love is no weak sentiment, and for Christ it led to crucifixion. To all our mates on the bike scene, we are a club that exists not for ourselves, but for our non-members. If you ever need an honest, believing friend, we are here for you, and so is Christ. Cheers, and God be with you. John Smith. God bless you.
Thank you for being here today. The impact that John Smith's life has had on every one of us is the reason why we are gathered here. I reckon Smithy would have loved to see this. Just so happens to be in a church called Wave Church. If there's one thing that John Smith was good at doing, it was making waves. And I believe if John was here with us today, he would be challenging us to never stop making waves for the cause of the gospel of Jesus Christ. When I was about 12 years old, my neighbours, Peter Bentley and his little brother Jeff, would go in on Monday nights, travel in from a little town called Kangaroo Ground, where I lived at the Wycliffe Bible Translators Base. And I don't know why Mum and Dad let me go, but they, on a Monday night, on a school night, they let me go in with Pete and Jeff Bentley in Pete's old E.H. Holden. And we'd travel into 265 Canterbury Road, Bayswater, where I heard, like never before, the message of Jesus Christ. The way that John Smith communicated the stories of the Gospels, the letters of Paul. As a young man, I can remember thinking to myself, that's the Jesus that I want to follow. That's the Jesus that I want to live my life for. And Smithy had this incredible way of bringing the Bible to life. And as a young man, I made a decision in those years to live my life for the Lord. And I'm so grateful to John and Glenna and the family, to God Squad, to Truth and Liberation, and to all of the fellowships that John and Glenna have been involved in, for the wonderful witness and example that you have been. This is another song that John loved, and you can sing it with me today. Like a river attendeth my way, when sorrows like sea billows roll, whatever my lot, thou hast taught me to say, it is well, it is well with my soul. With my soul, it is well, it is well with my soul. Though Satan should buffet, though trials should come, let this blessed assurance control that sin, oh the bliss of this glorious thought, my sin not in part but the whole, is nailed to the cross and I bear it no more. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, oh my soul. It is well with my soul.
Heart's racing a million miles an hour right now. I can just feel all the emotion in the air and all people from different walks of life. But I'd like to firstly acknowledge spirit and the spirits of this land, the traditional human beings of this land. I think it's really important to pay our respects of our roots and where we come from. And it's my true blessing and honor to do that on behalf of all the beautiful cousins here, my sisters, my brothers, and yeah, talk about Pa from a different angle, a different light, how we saw Pa and our relationship with him. Boy, he was an unusual man. He was a funny man. It was always a story. And the story always went on. He's like a mummy rising from the dead sometimes. Oh, what's happened to Pa this time? It'd be a stonefish or a blue box jellyfish, or he'd be catching a brown snake. And as a young whippersnapper, this really activated something inside, I'm sure all of us, you know, of pushing our limits, going out into the wilderness and seeking something deeper, you know, something that's greater than ourselves. I think that's, you know, the human quest of, you know, why we're given life, why we're given breath. And yeah, some memories from when we were little. I remember it would have been the first 5 years. We were living with Grandpa and close around the corner as well. And you know, I'd crawl up the stairs and I'd enter his study room and he'd have this big array of books just coating the walls like some big tapestry. And then you'd look around and you see this big great white shark jaw and I'd shit myself a little bit. Like, what's going on here, you know? And then you do another, you know, 90 degree turn and you'd see this wall just full of vases of all these different colours and all these different animals of snakes and insects, and you'd just be blown away. You just, I don't know, it was pretty special. He was a really special man and he touched so many people's lives. And, you know, one thing that I've been reflecting upon recently is Pa was so loving, he was kind, he was compassionate, he always cared, and he always went that extra mile, you know, especially for us grandkids. It was all those little things that he did for us that we're eternally grateful for. You know, you never take those little things for granted, I don't think. Well, I don't, but yeah, it was always, you know, he'd always be down for a chat and he always talking about his, you know, his stories and his philosophy and he loved life. He lived life. That was something about my pa that I really admired. And his core value, going, linking back to God, what is God? We're always continuously asking this question. And I don't really know, but in the core of me, I feel like it's love. It's unconditional love. And that's what he shared with all of us. And I just want you to try and re-remember that. Come back to that. Come back to yourself. Because, you know, that's why we're here. We're here to spread that in and amongst, you know, all walks of life, all colours, all shapes, all sizes. And that was part of his mission, was connecting with so many different people around social injustices, you know, about people being disadvantaged, about the Indigenous people, you know, about Mother Earth. He was always out in nature connecting, you know, in. And yeah, very, very admirable, to say the very least. And it's humbling, you know. I just want to take a moment for everyone to close their eyes and to reflect back on experiences and memories in silence that they've shared with my pa. So if we could do that now, that'd be amazing. Take a deep breath in and out. You can open your eyes now. I'm just thinking of some funny stories. But yeah, coming back to some of the things, some of the fundamental core beliefs I believe my grandpa had, and they were truth, love, light, loving your neighbours, loving yourself, and forgiveness. I think forgiveness is a really important one, you know. We've all had our trials and tribulations, and, you know, sometimes we're wrong, and that's really hard to own that and step up to that. And it's good to be challenged. It's healthy to push ourselves and I want to go over to his book now, On the Side of the Angels. That's really where I hope he is now. I hope he's in peace. I hope he's with his father, his saviour, and I hope they're having a beautiful time together. And with all our love, I know, I feel like he's looking down on us today. And on behalf of the grandchildren, I'd like to say thank you, Pa. Thank you for everything you've done. As the bishop said to the actress, it's all very wonderful. Oh, we still don't know what the bishop said. Some things are better left a mystery, you know? Still trying to work it out, but anyways. Maybe someday when I see him again. Yeah. Yeah. Okay, I love you all, brothers and sisters.
Hi, everybody. Thanks for coming. Really appreciate all those who've travelled far to be here today to honour Dad's legacy. Family, thank you. Dad's brother and sisters for travelling all the way from Queensland. I haven't prepared anything, so I'm just trying to move with the spirit here. I feel like I'm feeling really good with what's said, so I don't feel like I need to say much, but it's been a real honour to share Dad with you all. And it's okay. I don't have any memories of a lonely little child sitting there missing my dad. And in fact, we were all having one Easter. We would have been really young, Paul, me and Lyndall, when we were having a devotional time at Easter. So it must have been a rare moment that we're actually just home as a family during Easter, because we usually had Easter camps. And on reflecting back now, just the other day I was thinking, wow, Dad must have had that real moment of, oh, family, and what are they missing on? Is this all worth it? What am I sacrificing? And he did put it to us and ask us and gave us that choice and said to us, if there's any time you want me to quit ministry to be home with you as a family, I will, no questions asked, that's it. And yeah, like I said, we were only really young, and so it's like a child to try to explain how we felt as little children. It was just a no-brainer. It was, we understood as little kids that something big was outside of our little family unit. And yeah, we've struggled, I guess, over the years, but just got to live in faith and hope that everything's going to be all right in the end. And appreciate those people that pray for us as a family. Awesome memories as a child, like just my daddy. We used to play snuggle pot and cuddle pie. I don't know if some of you older people will remember May Gibbs. And my sister and I were snuggle pot and cuddle pie, and my brother was the lizard and my dad was the Banksia man. And he used to chase us around the house, and he was really rough. He'd get us down on the ground and he'd tickle us and give us horse bites and you give up. So I have really precious memories of a fun dad, you know, that wrestled around and had fun with us, and awesome memories of holidays, and so much he's taught us to appreciate nature and all the little things. I haven't really held space yet as a daughter that's just lost her daddy. So that's going to be really hard in the months and years ahead. But I've just been these last couple of weeks so grateful. And so grateful that I got to be there, that my kids got to be there, his grandchildren got to be there towards the end. To put him on his side, make him comfortable, ready to go to sleep. And that Mum was honoured in the end to have that intimate time with Dad and fall asleep together. And so I really feel God honoured Mum and Dad and giving them that form of death, I guess you'd call it. So, yeah, I guess the testimony was the night that we had Dad laying in wait for 17 hours. Again, that was a really precious gift where the children and I were able to have that special time. And then that night, lying in bed with my kids, it was past midnight, and we were telling, the kids were all telling stories, and we were laughing and we were crying, and it hit me. I was like, all those years as a child that I didn't have my dad around much, it's come full circle. And I'm okay that my dad might have had a few lonely years with not many people visiting him bedside. It's, I look at it as a blessing, you know. So he wasn't off on too many missions, and we kind of had him all to ourselves finally. And just listening to the kids' stories, Dad in a way became quite childlike. And they used to get up to mischief. Often he'd be seen riding down on his scooter, dogs on his knees, kids running after him, some on skateboards, and they'd rock up to the shops all together. And Taylan was telling me, Gren would say, "Don't buy sushi for Pa, he doesn't need to eat any sushi." And Taylan told me, "I used to always buy sushi for Pa, and we'd go sit in the park and eat it before we got home." Or the other story of, it was only a couple of weeks before Dad passed away. My boys are real keen fishermen, but they, on the move, if they're not catching anything here for a half hour, they're moving on to the next spot. Taylan said to me, "Oh, Mum, it was only a couple of weeks ago. We went fishing with Pa. He sat on that scooter for 8 hours, 20 rods in the water." And he said, "We were so exhausted, me and Levi. But he just kept fishing and fishing until finally he said, 'Let's go buy some fish and chips.'" What a relief. But then Pa said, "Okay, now we've finished eating. Should we go back and fish or should we go home?" Or little Shara saying, "What about the time Pa ran over me with his scooter?" And then them all saying, "Yeah, me too, me too." I don't think literally ran over, but, you know. So, yeah, I just thought I'd share a couple of those stories because I'm just feeling really blessed that it's come full circle and that my kids got this precious time. And we've had so far in this service all about this tribute to the big JS. But I knew him just as Daddy, and I knew all his faults. I know people struggle with him sometimes, as I did. My kids used to roll their eyes because me and my dad debated, discussed, got frustrated with each other right till the end. But yeah, as a busy single mum with six kids, it sort of got hard to even give my dad much time. So I'm just taking that with me, that my dad and my children had that precious end years. And I'll leave it at that. But yeah, thanks.
I think about 30 years ago, I was asked to bring a package to a guy called John Smith. Never heard of him. Turned up in Holland to find this hairy, leather-clad, old biker-looking dude surrounded by a bunch of misfits. Holding court, he would talk and talk and talk and talk until eventually I got bored and butted in and said, "Hey mate, I gotta give you these." As soon as he heard my accent, he said, "Oh, where are you from in Ireland?" I said, "Belfast." He said, "What can we do to fix that problem?" Now, I don't know if you know anything about Irish people, but we really hate foreigners telling us what to do, especially when we don't know how to fix it ourselves. And he suggested that we met every night in a pub. And we did. Every night of the festival, we went to a little pub. And we sat and we talked about all the things we had in common. We talked about Scotch whiskey. We talked about art and we talked about Scotch whiskey. We talked about the blues and Scotch whiskey. He showed me pictures of you two in his living room, of all his little kids and Kathy, and they're all just little kids. And a picture of Glenna in a leather miniskirt, which he was very fond of. And he gave me a bit of advice before we left. He didn't talk the Jesus thing at all, hardly, to me. But before we left, he says, you know, go home and just read the words of Jesus, then do the words of Jesus. And I'd read the words of Jesus many times, but for some reason what he said made sense, and I went home and I only read the words of Jesus. It's good advice, added advice, everyone here to take that advice. Just read the words of Jesus, see what they do to you. Take them seriously. And John and I toured in Scotland often, all over the place, but when he found out that in Scotland the symbol of God's spirit is not the gentle dove, but rather the wild goose, you know, that awkward, honking, crazy, angry bird that disobeys everything else and ignores borders. And I could never figure out why John liked that so much. The last time I saw him, he said he was just going to ride the wild goose. And I trust he is. I trust he is. I am the wild goose. Climb aboard me and I will take you to better weather. With the south wind in my feathers, I will carry you home again. Weary clansmen, leave Culloden and let your lifeblood feed the red bird in Caledonia and fields of Flodden. I will carry you home again. The wild goose, climb aboard me, and I will take you to better weather. With the south wind in my feathers, I will carry you home. Gray skies, a silver lining, and in my highlands, a sun is shining. You will be safe there, my wings are waiting, waiting to carry you home.
I will carry you home again.
Well, our service is drawing to a close now, and some time ago, John asked that I would preach the message or a message today of the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ, and of course, I'm very willing to do that. But so much has been said already that illustrates and represents John's faith. I want to say to the kids here that, look, this all started at a time when John just received Jesus into his heart by faith. That's where it all began. And the life of God just came into his soul. And all of this that we've been talking about and reminiscing about happened out of that. You know, I don't know why John wasn't given an AO. I don't know why he wasn't invited to be Governor General or stuff like that. But I think he was in a different category, don't you? And he was amongst those who, what does it say in the word? It says that God has appointed apostles, evangelists, teachers, pastors. He's appointed those, and they are the ones that create true community. They are the ones who bring out reality. They are the ones who speak that which will stir people's hearts to love each other as Jesus loves them. And that's what he did. He was in a different category. He wasn't in the secular category. He was in the lasting category, wasn't he? And I just want to say this in the message. I want to say that, and this comes back to the John Wesley, John Smith. When John Wesley appointed his circuit riders, he was looking for two things. He was looking for the gifts and the graces. The gifts and the graces. And when Methodist preachers went around, they had an annual district meeting, and each Methodist minister had to stand up while others were asked to answer for him. Did he have the gifts and the graces for the work? And John used to quote that. He had the graces. Was John perfect? Well, listening to some of the things that have been said, you might say probably he was. But I want to say this. Was John perfect? Well, yes and no. And I come back to Wesley again, because Wesley was the one, I think, who went further than the reformers. He understood the rebirth of the soul, and he preached it and taught it and loved to see England come alive with the love of God. When you look at that word, perfection, it's not a moral, static thing. Jesus said, be perfect as your heavenly Father is perfect. If you give to those who won't give back to you, if you loan not expecting to have it returned, but you keep on living like that, if you give it out, that's being perfect. You know, you fill up a glass and it's not full until it's overflowing. And you check out the word perfect, it means overflowing. Check it out in the New Testament. And I reckon John overflowed a lot, don't you? Sometimes maybe he didn't. And there were times when there was some tension in relationships, but he overflowed. And you people too are living like that. Keep living like that. And don't let anybody put you off. This poor old tired nation of ours needs people who overflow with the holy love of God. Not just seeking their own interests, but pouring out the love of God from their lives in just ordinary, simple ways. Sometimes just a smile to somebody is what does it, right through to all sorts of levels. But I want to focus in concluding now on the gift. And about a year ago when I was asked to do this today, when the day came, there was a text that slipped into my mind straight away. And here it is. It's from the Acts of the Apostles. This is about the Apostle Paul. So he reasoned, / debated, / argued. He reasoned in the synagogue with both Jews and God-fearing Greeks, as well as in the marketplace, day by day, with those who happened to be there. I reckon that's a text for Smithy, don't you? He was the superlative debater. And he debated for truth's sake, didn't he? I worked closely with John, and if you were going to put up a proposition that he didn't sort of agree with, all of a sudden, I've got five reasons why I can't agree with that. And I learned, just pick on one. Don't try and work on the five. It's not going to work. John would go to universities, and some of you guys in the squad, you remember this so well, Monash and Melbourne and other universities in the country, and he'd speak to the students. Some 200 or 300 students be lined up, lunch hour meeting maybe, and their professors and lecturers would be at the back. And he'd do it so brilliantly, so penetratingly. He understood his subject so well. You know, I reckon John, you know, he got a PhD over there in Asbury. He could have got multiple PhDs just on one particular area of music that he plumbed into, as we heard earlier on. Very, very sharp and penetrating. Loved to get into the guts of it, into the truth of it. And I said to John one day, I said, John, when you go to those universities, what... And you speak, what do you actually what is your aim? What do you try to do? Do you try to win the argument? And he paused. He knew it was a serious question, and he paused. He said, No, I don't try and win the argument. I just try and make their argument bleed. I like the students to know that the secular humanist, the materialist presuppositions of their lecturers and professors are flawed and they bleed. And a lot of people hearing his talks, with their minds enlivened and their hearts warmed, sought further to understand where all this came from. And they saw it in the face of Jesus. And they turned to the New Testament and they began reading the Word of God, the words of Jesus, the whole Bible here and there. And they thought about it as they read it. And lo and behold, they understood it. And people came to faith. And kids, please do that as you go on. You know, time just races on, doesn't it? I said to a 20-year-old that I was coming across to this service, the memorial service of John Smith. He looked at me and said, gee, that's a weird name, isn't it? I'd never thought of that. He thought I was sort of bringing up something, John Citizen, something like that. Look, time goes by, but the message is unchanging. And there are heaps of people across this land that are alive to God and just given off good because I heard it through the lips of this Australian John Wesley. So I want to say this in closing. I want to say this. Jesus Christ is the Lord of all. He right now knows our thoughts. He loves us from heaven. He speaks well of his faithful people. One of our earlier speakers perhaps expressed a little bit of hopefulness about John being there. He is there. Let me put it like this. In the book of Hebrews, we have this text. I think this is one of John's favourites. It says, we have this hope as an anchor for the soul, firm and secure. It enters the inner sanctuary behind the curtain. Maybe we could interpret that as our true home, that place where our hearts long for, even if we don't really understand it, that place of true acceptance and love of us as we are. Somebody said to me at the beginning of this service, they said, boy, everybody coming together like this, this is like a taste of heaven. We're all reconnecting and seeing each other 40 years ago. It takes a few minutes just to get the recognition factors happening. But here we are, a little taste of how it's going to be. But here's this text. We have this hope as an anchor for the soul, firm and secure, fixed and fast. It enters into our true home where Jesus, who went before us, has entered on our behalf. That little phrase, went before us, in some translations is forerunner. You might know that word. Jesus is our forerunner. And that translates a Greek word, prodomos, which was used for the little tender boat that went out to the big merchant ship just out from the port of Alexandria in the ancient world, and would carry the anchor and the lanyard of the big ship, would carry it back to the wharf. And the wharf labourers would haul the big ship in. That's the word that is used of Jesus. He has gone ahead of us. He has gone ahead of us through time. He has gone ahead of us and he has anchored, fixed and firm the anchor of your soul into your true home. He's done that. He has made sure that your relationship with the dear Father in the true home which he has gone ahead to prepare is absolutely and totally secure. You know, in the last probably couple of years in my communications with John, I noticed a as a pastor, I noticed a kind of a developing meekness in John. Now, that's a biblical word, and it means an increasing resting in God. It means an increasing sense of my own helplessness and that God is my helper, that I can do nothing of myself to advance myself in any way. It takes us a while to learn these things. And that was happening in John. It's a beautiful thing indeed. May it happen in us, each one of us, that we might exalt in the Lord Jesus Christ and speak well of him, that the afflicted might hear and be glad who are around us. Jesus has gone ahead of us. The New Testament documents, kids, are the most contemporary, most up-to-date documents you could possibly come across. And it tells us that Jesus has gone ahead of us. He is the Lord of all, and he has anchored your soul into your true home. Where he is, there one day you will be. It's not just overcoming death. It's relationship with the living God forever. Do you like that? Well, that's the gospel. Shall we pray? Father, we thank you for all these expressions of gift that you have given to your servant for the sake of the people of this land. We thank you for the graces that you have given to him, which caused the light of your presence to shine through him, just as the light of the moon is not its own, but the light of the sun which it reflects. We thank you, Father, for these treasured memories, and we thank you for the gospel that brought it all to life and was its engine room, was its source and was its glory, is with us now and continues on. And we pray your blessing upon this beloved family here today and upon each one who holds fast to the rock of our salvation. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Folk, you may be wondering what this globe is doing on John's motorcycle. It's been said here that the world was John's parish. And in this globe, we have John's ashes, his earthly remains. Of course, we believe John is in heaven, but we're left with this. Later after this service, we'll take these ashes down and cast them into the rip. But I wanted you to know what the significance of this is. We've got a Barry Maguire song now, and a Barry Maguire original, Take This Bread. So John's brother-in-law, Paul Baker, has the communion bread and the communion wine, which we're going to place onto this old stump here, this gnarled old stump, which reminds us also of John, with the bruises and the cuts and the stab wounds and the scars of life. So just wait while we hear Barry Maguire, and then after that we'll have a brief grab of John at his best. So stay with us, folk.
Amen. it, take it, and drink it. And each time you do, sing it now.
John the Baptist, man, if he was the equivalent of a rock and roll singer, he would have been you two at the best, because he preached against hypocrisy amongst the religious dudes. He preached about the need to repent and to care about the poor. I mean, John was fantastic. He was courageous. Mate, he rocked it when it came to preaching. And then all of a sudden, Jesus comes. And nobody wants to hear him anymore. And you guys are performers, you know what I mean. When you're wired to perform, it's not just an ego, it's not an arrogant thing, but you're wired for it. You want to serve your audience. You want the people listening to you to feel that they've enjoyed what they're getting. And there's stuff there. You know that, Woody. There's a connection thing for people that are performers. What does it do when you completely lose all of that? John the Baptist lost it all. Not only that, and I mean, he intrigued. The very people that put him in jail used to like to hear him. They were so intrigued by him. And they jailed him. And you know the story. There was stuff going on, incestuous relationships going on. That was part of the whole Herodian family. They were full of this stuff. And of course, John the Baptist, mate, you talk about angry songs. He sang an angry song and he got straight in their face about the way they were living. And so he got put in jail. And of course, one of the women involved in this incestuous relationship was very angry. And her daughter, you remember, was a really sexy dancer and really got into the eyes of the man in charge. And he was so besotted, he offered anything she wanted. And Mum said, ask him for John the Baptist's head on a plate. I don't know about you, but the man that Jesus said was the greatest man that had ever lived to that time. Well, I want to say, Jesus, how can a man like that have his head taken off and stuck on a plate and handed out in a party? I mean, that is so undignified. I mean, shoot him or something, but it just seems to be just absolutely wrong. As wrong as I felt about what was happening to JB and worse. And so he's in prison, he's awaiting that execution. And nobody wants to hear him anymore. He's just got a couple of his road crew are still hanging around. And he says to him, will you go and talk to Jesus? Maybe I was wrong. Will you go and talk to Jesus and just ask him, are you really the Messiah? The one I said, behold, the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. Will you go and ask him if he really is the one? Or should I be looking for someone else? Now, man, that makes my gut move. A man of his kind of courage, a man who'd stood up against people that could take his head off like that and who did, to lose his nerve, he must have felt so depressed. And when I see my mate committing suicide so depressed, I know that doesn't necessarily mean ungodliness. I think we're past the day when we think if you're a godly person, you can't suffer depression. I think we're well past that now. I think we're much more sensible. We understand that. John the Baptist is depressed, as my mate was. Is he the Messiah? And I want to finish this story tonight with this. Jesus actually went away for a bit on his own because he loved his cousin and he was devastated. after John was executed. We hear he went off to be on his own. He was hurting. Why he didn't step in, I don't know. But he was certainly hurting. But just before that was to happen, when the doubts were given, and a couple of the road crew turned up and said, Jesus, our mate John the Baptist is in prison. He's likely to be executed, but he wants to know, did he make a mistake? Are you really the one? Are you the main man? Are you the Son of God? Are you the one that's been sent to save the world? And Jesus said, you go tell John simply this. Go tell John what you've heard me saying and what you've seen me doing. And I tell you, folks, if you watch us in the church, if you watch my life for all of it, you'd have enough reason if you want to be a cynic to say, well, Smitty, you did this, you did that. If you want to watch the popes, well, I've just been reading about the popes in the 1400s, mate, and about Savonarola, who they hung and burnt to a crisp and shed his ashes on the Arno River because he spoke out against popes that were siring children and all sorts of stuff going on. If you want to look at the church, you can find enough reason, if you want to be negative, to give up on it all. If you want to look at the best of the church, like hospitals, that's where hospitals came from in the first centuries. If you want to look what the church did in the first three centuries to give dignity to women, if you want to see how the church stopped infanticide that was legally acceptable if it was a girl baby in the Roman Empire, if you want to look at what happened during the Methodist days when they went out to stop slavery and stop the conditions that were going on in prisons, there's enough to believe in too. But in the end, you can find enough crap on the way through to be cynical, but you can't find it in Jesus, buddy. Read the story. Read the story. Read the story. Get the story right. Don't make one up. The story of Jesus is one who can say, check out what I said and check out what I did, and it won't be imperfect like your life and my life. And that's what the message was to John the Baptist. Jesus, you tell him what you see, that the blind are getting their sight back, that broken people are being healed. And more than that, you go tell him that the good news of God's love is being preached to the poor. It's no longer to the nice guys sitting in a synagogue in the church. These are the guys. This is the message that goes out to the rock and roll kids at the concerts. This is the message that goes to the headquarters of the Hell's Angels. This is a message that goes to homeless people. This is a message that goes to those who are depressed and broken and suffering from mental illness. Go tell him that the good news is preached to the poor, not just to those that have got their stuff together, but to those who haven't. And that's why the story of Jesus has got me and has kept me for so many years with all the failings and weaknesses. I recommend to you tonight the greatest story of all time. The story of one who said to John the Baptist, check out what I do and check out what I've been saying and check out who I've been saying it to. If you're not a Christian here tonight, look at the story of Jesus and you'll find an answer you won't find any place else. And if you are a Christian tonight, remember that our calling is to be like him. That's why we went to the outdoors. That's why I went to get involved in rock and roll music and all sorts of stuff like that. Because if I'm going to say I believe the story is that he said, follow me, follow me, follow me. So he's a friend of the outcasts and I'm going to follow him, then I'm going to be a friend of the outcasts. And while the church can be all singing the happy songs on Sunday morning, the JBs with their Jimi Hendrix dogs have a right to hear the good news. Jesus wants to send us to them. And for those of you that are believers, Read the story, not just so that you may think how great it was the day you accepted Jesus, how great it was to know that you had your way to heaven, but greater than that, how great it was to feel the power within you to overcome your own weaknesses and failings, to find love where there was doubt and fear before. But beyond that, read the story and know that it's not good enough to just be glad you met him. It's only good enough if, having met him, you follow him all the days of your life.
Explain to the fishermen here and fisher ladies what we're doing, that we've been to a very special funeral and that we're now going to symbolically cast the ashes. But what I want to say before Mark gives the benediction is that we've been really fortunate to have an unusual man in our lives. So I want to pray with you and for you right now. So, dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for John's life. We thank you for the influence that he's been on us and on other people. We thank you for the stand he has taken on behalf of other people. We thank you that those people have recognized John and have attended his legacy service today. But now we reach a point, Heavenly Father, where we want to give back to the world, who was John's parish, the ashes, John's mortal remains. We know you have his spirit with you. We know he's with you in heaven, Heavenly Father. But what we're left with here in this time and space and bound by emotions like we are in this earthly experience, we only know that we've got these earthly remains where the ocean will take John's ashes out into the rest of the world. We won't see, but Heavenly Father, symbolically, we want to do this, and we need to do this because we want to inspire other people to be inspired to walk in Jesus' footsteps just as John did. We pray these things and all of the many prayers unsaid this day in the name of the Father and the Son
and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
So,
so Kathy's casting the ashes in.
Hi, Pa. Love you, Pa. Love you.
It's all very wonderful. It's all very wonderful.
Glory with exceeding joy to the only wise God, our Saviour, be glory and majesty, dominion and power, now and forever. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
There's a land that is fairer than day, and by faith we can see it afar. For the Father waits over the way to prepare us a dwelling place there. In the sweet by and by, we shall meet on that beautiful shore. In the sweet by and by, we shall meet on that beautiful shore. We shall sing on that beautiful shore the melodious songs of the blessed, and our spirits shall sorrow no more. Not a sigh for the blessing of rest. In the sweet by and by, shall meet on that beautiful shore. In the sweet by and by, we shall meet on that beautiful shore. Glorious gift of